Okay, welcome everybody, and thank you very much for coming again. My name is Ricardo Vinuesa. I'm an associate professor at KTH in Stockholm, working with machine learning, fluid mechanics, simulations of complex turbulent flows. And today I'm going to tell you a little bit about coherent structures in turbulence. These are basically the building blocks of turbulence, being able to understand how these coherent structures are affecting the flow. Really helps us to not only learn something about the physics, but also hopefully be able to obtain simplified models to control and to do something on the flow that can be helpful from a perspective of applications. So let me start with some classical literature and also by saying, well, what is a coherent structure? And in the literature, there are many different definitions in different contexts. For example, in the context of modal decompositions, coherent structures are associated with features obtained in particular individual modes. Here, we're going to use a slightly different definition. We're going to consider a coherent structure as a three-dimensional region of the flow, which is satisfying a particular property. This is given by this threshold over here. So if that property is larger or equal than a particular threshold, then we will consider that a coherent structure. Okay, so we can actually see them in 3D. We can visualize them instantaneously in 3D. We're also going to look first at homogeneous isotropic turbulence, HIT. In homogeneous isotropic turbulence, you have basically a box, a cube, without any walls, that is tri-periodic. And those fluctuations, those turbulent fluctuations, are maintained with a particular forcing. The interest of looking at this particular type of turbulence is the fact that there are no inhomogeneities in the properties of turbulence. In other words, whatever is a large scale is a large scale everywhere in the box, and whatever is a small scale everywhere in the box. This is relevant for what I will be mentioning later in the context of wall-bounded turbulence. So first, in this classical work by Jiménez and Moisi, collaborators, there were two types of structures being analyzed in homogeneous isotropic turbulence, or structures associated with vorticity, which are basically normalized with the vorticity fluctuations, and structures associated with strain, also normalized with the RMS of the strain. It's important to note that everywhere in this box, in this setup, you will have this sort of spectra and this sort of cascade. So you have the larger scales, which are these ones over here. Those are usually energy containing. And then the spectrum of dissipation, which is centered around this point, those are usually associated with smaller scales. So there is a direct cascade from larger to smaller scales, which is actually quite interesting to analyze in the context of this homogeneous isotropic turbulence, because again, whatever a large scale is going to be the same in the whole domain, and in the whole domain, a small scale is going to be small. Okay? This allows us, this which in principle seems like a triviality, allows us to use a particular threshold that is going to be the same everywhere in the domain. Okay? So we don't need to take into account the distance from any wall to set the threshold everywhere in the domain. This threshold can be constant because the limit between a large and a small scale is going to be the same in the whole box. Here I'm showing you some examples of vorticity structures. These vorticity structures are essentially containing energy. You can see their typology. They're actually quite corrugated. They're kind of like worms, if you wish. It's important to note that these structures, they get smaller as the threshold gets higher. So typically, the condition that is being used to identify these structures is the RMS of the vorticity. So we will consider coherent structures as the regions of vorticity, instantaneous vorticity, that are much larger than the RMS of the vorticity. And that threshold, if it's made higher, then the structures will be smaller, because a smaller region of the domain will be satisfying that condition. This is classical work, by the way, of Moisi and Jiménez from 2004. Another type of structure that can be identified in homogeneous isotropic turbulence is this less worm-like feature. It's actually more like like sponges, if you wish, or like plates. These are more like flat type of configurations. These are in fact strain structures. So these structures are more closely connected with dissipation. As before, if the threshold gets larger, the structures will become smaller. So there is a bit of an interesting assessment when we're looking at types of structures in the context of homogeneous isotropic turbulence. Vorticity, energy containing, strain associated with dissipation. What happens when I have a wall-bounded turbulence? When I have a wall, okay, so I don't have a triperiodic box anymore, I have a wall, and then the other directions may or may not be periodic, but the wall normal direction is inhomogeneous. What happens is that the wall is segregating the flow. So each wall normal location can be understood as a different local cascade. This is actually observed in this nice representation by Jimenez in the annual review paper quite some years ago. Well, you can see over here the spectrum of, basically the energetic extractors, no? This would be associated with production. And then here you have the spectrum of the dissipation. So what is interesting is the fact that the larger scale extractors associated with energy close to the wall, those extractors are much smaller than far away from the wall. This line over here is associated with the, well, with basically with the overlap layer. So you have a logarithmic growth in the size of the energy containing extractors. And of course, the dissipative extractors, they have a bit of a more uniform size as I go larger in Y, but still, the size still changes. So a small scale dissipative extractor, it doesn't have exactly the same size everywhere, but there is a significant change when I'm looking at the energy containing vortices. Okay? This basically requires a threshold that is changing with the wall normal direction. So if I'm normalizing with the local fluctuations, those fluctuations will change, of course, in the wall normal direction, and that threshold will that is changing will allow me to effectively identify what is a coherent extractor when I'm in different regions away from the wall. Now, how to identify extractors? Well, one classical way to do this is to look at vortices when I am in the context of wall-bounded flows. And one way to look at vortices is to look at the velocity gradient tensor. So basically, I'm looking at the partial derivatives of the velocity, so the partial derivatives of the various velocity components with respect to the various spatial directions. That's the velocity gradient tensor. This velocity gradient tensor can be decomposed into a symmetric plus an anti-symmetric part. The symmetric part S is the strain, and the anti-symmetric part omega is the rotation. So essentially, the velocity gradient tensor is expressed as a strain plus a rotation. And then there are different ways of using the velocity gradient tensor to define vortices. There are different approaches, but essentially, generally, a vortex is a region where the rotational part is dominant. And that's kind of like a loose definition, which can be more precisely concretized when we look at different criteria. There's, of course, and you can see, these are some of the most popular criteria for identifying vortices. There is the Q criterion, which is very well known. You can see the definition here. It has to do, again, with regions connecting the rotation and the strain components. There is also the delta criterion, or D criterion also sometimes, which again is connected with the invariance of the velocity gradient tensor. And then there is perhaps the most well-known criterion, the so-called lambda 2. And the lambda 2 criterion by Jeong and Hussein, this is a very famous reference, where we are actually calculating this quantity over here. So x squared plus omega squared, that can be written in this form in the context of incompressible flows. And then what we are doing is that we are picking the second eigenvalue of this quantity over here, of this matrix that we obtain here. And that second eigenvalue will be the one that will be, well, essentially defining a region that is a vortex. These three criteria are providing very similar results, very similar structures. In the paper by Jeon and Hussein, there are some particular cases where this method performs a bit better, but in general, the results are reasonably similar. And again, this identify vertical extractors, so these vortex tubes that you can see in turbulent flows, for example, in this work by Del Alamo and others from 2006. This is another classical work of extractor identification. So basically what you can do is, in this case, they use the delta criterion, but again, it would be similar to use other methods, and they identify vortices as the regions where delta, this quantity delta that I showed you before, is larger than the RMS of delta, which depends on the wall normal direction, times some constant d. What does this mean? It means that because the wall introduces an inhomogeneity, the fluctuations are different in different regions. At the wall there is no fluctuation, in the near wall region they're very strong, and the outer region they go down again. I'm using the local value of those fluctuations to scale my threshold. So it will be more difficult for a region of the flow to become a structure if the local fluctuations in that region are very strong already. And this wall normal varying threshold is ensuring that only the most intense events everywhere in the domain are actually becoming a structure. Okay? And over here you can see two examples, one attached and one detached vertical motion, vortex clusters. You can see that these are very, they're like tubes, they're like filaments. So again, these are connected with vorticity, but this is not just vorticity, this is a vortex, right? And there's of course a distinction when you have turbulent flows. You want to really make sure that you don't only pick regions of a strong vorticity, but regions where you have what we can define as a vortex, okay? So this is the classical work of Delalamo and others. There is other interesting work to look at other types of coherent structures. There is work by Lozano Duran and others, where essentially what they do is try to extend the classical quadrant analysis. No? The quadrant analysis, Liu and Wilmarth, for example, worked quite a lot on it. What we do is that we look at the flow in the context of the fluctuations in the string-wise and wall normal directions. Okay? So you have these two axes. You can decompose the fluctuations into these four quadrants. So you see that depending on the relative signs of U prime, the string-wise fluctuations, and D prime, the wall normal fluctuations, you can have four cases. Turns out that the dominant events in turbulence are these two that are on this diagonal. What is called the Q2s. If I start from here, we'll have the Q1, Q2, Q3, and Q4 events. The Q2s are the so-called ejections, where the string-wise velocity is negative and the wall normal velocity is positive. And the Q4 events, those are the sweeps, where the string-wise velocity is positive and the wall normal velocity is negative. So the ejections go like this, the sweeps go like this. Now, this classical quadrant analysis in two dimensions can be extended to 3D if we consider regions where locally we have a very large product of UV. Okay, so you take the instantaneous string-wise fluctuation, you multiply by the instantaneous wall normal fluctuation, and you look at regions where this product is larger than the URMS times the VRMS times some threshold H. This threshold H is defining basically how large I want this term to be, how restrictive I want to be in terms of my definition of structures. This is typically decided by doing percolation analysis to maximize the number of structures, and that is one typical approach to do it. In any case, what you can see is in a channel, both the U and V RMS are going to change in the wall normal direction, and that will naturally give me a way to normalize my fluctuations to identify structures, okay? So taking this quadrant analysis and doing it in 3D, this is again work by Lozano Duran and others from 2012, this is some years ago. What you can do in a channel is identify the three-dimensional regions that satisfy the equation that I showed you before. These so-called Q events, because they come from the quadrant analysis, they can also be understood as three-dimensional regions of intense Reynolds stress. So these intense Reynolds stress are regions of high correlation of U and V. Here you can see an attached vortex cluster, so you can see how it looks like. Here you can see an attached Q2 event. Remember that the Q2s are the ejections. Yeah? So this is an attached is because the lower part of the structure is very close to the wall, so it's attached to the wall. There are also detached events, which are not so close to the wall, but these ones are attached. And then you can see what is called an attached large-scale Q2 event. So this would be a small attached ejection. This would be a very large attached ejection. Okay, so you can see that they look a bit different, the vortex clusters and the Reynolds stress events, the Q events. They're both important in the context of turbulence. They both contain an important part of the dynamics of the flow. The vortex clusters are connected with energy, and the Reynolds stresses are connected with basically with the UVs, no? With the momentum transfer but they are also important for the energy of the flow. So you can see different types of structures that you can see in your turbulent flow. And there's been some recent work also in the context of our group trying to extend this analysis to more complicated geometries. So here there is the work of Azzori and others where we try to identify these UVs, so these intense Q events in turbulent ducts. Ducts are interesting because in addition to the walls, you also have vertical panels that introduce corners, and in those secondary motions in the corners, one can have interesting properties of the structures. And then more recently, we have also worked together with Azzori and others in the context of turbulent wings. So we have a turbulent wing, some of the previous videos that we have shown with DNS of these very, very complex geometries. And even here, you can identify these very complex Q events with a strong pressure gradients, with curvature, and with quite complex turbulence phenomena. So both references can be found at the bottom, Azzori and others, both in the International Journal of Heat and Fluid Flow, 2021 and 2022. So you can see all the information over there. And this is all that I wanted to talk about today. Again, this is our GitHub repository, so you can use the QR code and access all our information there. All our codes, the CFD part, databases, so just feel free to reach out if you want to access data, access codes, or collaborate. And I would like to once again thank you everybody who made this video possible, InfraVis, the KTH Visualization Studio, the KTH Digitalization Platform, and I'm very happy to stay in touch, to discuss more, and to collaborate if that's something of interest. Thank you very much, and have a great day.